Okay, hello friends, everyone. Welcome to our channel, as well as our innovation Crunching Tiger interview series. We'll get to speak some of the greatest global leaders in innovation. Today, we are honored to have the conversation with Mr. Paul Shi.
Hi.
And I really appreciate this special opportunity, so I would like to give some introduction of this great special opportunity. Then I will focus to introduce Professor Hsu, right? I'm Jili Chung. I wrote a book, published book in this November. It's called Innovation Crunching Tiger. This one. Okay. It's discuss the innovation ecosystem in Greater China region. I use the teaching from MIT Sloan School, we call the three lens methodology, to analyze the current phenomena and the many stories happen in Greater China. So we hope to make the reader to have a crystal understanding and obtain their own perspective, their own insight toward China's current situation. So the innovation ecosystem in China is composed of legal, financing, and the whole stuff. For example, we talk about the IP monetization. We also talk about the trade war's impact and the change making to the whole ecosystem. So after the publication of this book, very interesting, it's become a global project. As I speak to many friends over the world, they start feel this is very interesting to understand more about what's happening in China, because everybody knows trade war. Everybody wants to understand more how trade war is impact their life, impact their career. So when they understand there's a book published in English, focused in this area, they want to spread to the rest of the world. So the book is being translated into French, Spanish, and Italian. So I'm also looking forward to more partners from Germany and Japan to participate in this process. Okay, so we have the same goal. We want to promote mutual understanding. We want to promote friendly co-competition so as to maintain the prosperity of the global economy. So with that purpose and that theme that bring me to have this conversation with Professor Paul Shi. So let me bring the focus to Professor Paul Shi. Paul is my long-time mentor. He is the real expert in many areas, including corporate strategy, financial industry, intellectual property, and cross-border transaction. Paul is the founder and the CEO of an international consulting company, FICOS. He is also on the non-for-profit side, he's also the founding chairman of a Pope Foundation, which is the most important bridge between Taiwanese enterprise and leading global research institutes such as MIT, Harvard University, and Berkeley. Paul also served on the advisory board of many important international organizations such as OPEC, APEC, OECD, and WTO. And Paul has been in this professional area for almost half of the century, about 50 years, a pretty long time. He has been doing great work, innovative transaction, bringing a lot of technology and a global business model into Taiwan or into Greater China, help them land it in this region and promote the international cooperation. So with that amazing, tremendous experience, Paul, could you tell us more about what is your current pursuit? What kind of project that you are currently doing?
Not just my current pursuit, I also want to convince other people to pursue in the same way. Okay? I would say there are two important phenomena that has been sticking into my mind all these years. One is called new normal.
Okay? New normal.
Yeah, new normal. I think the meaning is clear. There's a, from time to time we have to face a new normal. That means the situation totally changed. Now, You know, I had to face a new environment, a new world. Mm-hmm. Now, I've been using a lot of terminology. I say, wow, we are facing a brand new world. Mm-hmm. But I will use the term that is commonly understood now. It's called new normal. The other phenomenon is called disruptive innovation. Mm-hmm. And as a Harvard professor, Christensen, he has been promoting that idea. Mm-hmm. So what I'm trying to say is these two phenomena always exist, but always being ignored.
Yes.
Okay? But this time, during the coronavirus situation, mm-hmm. These two phenomena standing out, okay. Because speed up acceptance for new normal is speed up the acceptance for disruptive innovation. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So new business model has to be changed, and a lot of things has to be changed. Mindset has to be changed. Mm-hmm. So under such pressure, I like to encourage people to take those pressure with pleasure, because you are dealing with the future. Mm-hmm. You must accept those pressure. But by acceptance, might as well take a very, very positive view, and not just accepting, but accept the pressure with delight. Mm-hmm. So maybe these statements serve as a start. Okay?
That's wonderful, and it's well said. We take this challenge with pressure. Yeah. We should feel honored that we have this opportunity mm-hmm. to deal with the situation and create the new future. And that actually bring me to a very, I would say, a very up-to-date topic, right? The pandemic, the COVID-19, mm-hmm. is something unprecedented. It's in this unprecedented period of time, we are facing many different kind of change or challenge. Paul, you just said you have two observations. I also have two observations during this unusual time. Mm-hmm. Number one, okay, I see the world is become even more digitalized mm-hmm. because of the pandemic. For example, today I sit here together with Paul and taking this video. Afterwards, we'll have the video recorded mm-hmm. and sent it to every place in the world through internet. So many people will receive this message. Mm-hmm. This is the power of digitalization. Mm-hmm. People have been doing this before. It just never, like right now, we are forced to do so, but we get used to do so. Mm-hmm. That's one observation. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, mm-hmm. the globalization is being stopped, right? We couldn't travel. We couldn't go to the international conference as before. We couldn't go back and forth frequently to meet friends mm-hmm. from all over the world, right? So on one hand, is foster the digitalization that we can access the world more quickly. On the other hand, it stop the old ways we doing globalization. So I'm curious and hope to learn from Paul, from your perspective, what kind of experience or what kind of reflection we could obtain from this unprecedented period of time.
Well, you mentioned a couple of times virus, this epidemic we are encountering is unprecedented. Mm. That's not necessarily true.
Okay.
In human history, there's always an epidemic. Okay? In the medieval time, the whole town in Europe has been wiped out. And in other parts of the world, we don't know because mm-hmm. there's no historical record.
Right.
Okay? So, the whole city being wiped out, a whole village being wiped out by, you know, different epidemic. Yeah, this is all recorded in the history.
Right.
But every time something like that happened, the people would adjust to mm-hmm. a new world, a new right. situation. Mm-hmm. Okay. Some people would devote themselves in studying the cause of the epidemic.
Right.
Okay? Like now, everybody is very eager in searching out how to come up with a new vaccine. There's social changes, economic, business model changes, and there's so many changes. So in that regard, I wouldn't say this is I'm a presidential. It happened before.
Okay. Okay.
But with the new technology, digitization of the world, we'll talk about digital economy, and that will be definitely affected. We're not able to travel now.
Right. Okay.
In the old days, I would travel a number of times to Boston, other parts of the world, to attend academic conferences, and then meet with people that we can share ideas together. So by airplane ticket, you travel all the way, you know, thousands of miles away to attend meetings, and you have to check into a hotel.
Right.
So simple thing, there's airfare expenses and hotel expenses, you have to spend a lot of money in order to attend a conference, intellectual and also academic interchange.
Right.
But under the new normal, there's a new terminology called webinar, okay? So we meet through the web.
Okay? Right.
And I think this week will become a new normal.
Become a new normal.
In the future, do we have to travel all the way, thousands of miles away to have meetings? Do we have to check into a hotel? So this means that will change.
Right.
But would that change other human behavior, like traveling for pleasure? The problem would not. Okay? But for comfort, I often had an experience. You travel to a beautiful city, thousands of miles away, but you end up seeing nothing because you lock up
in the
conference room, in the meeting room all the time.
Right.
And then when meeting is over, you had a few hours left to catch the airplane coming back, and then that's the only time you have to visit the city.
Yes.
So I think all this will be changed. Okay? Maybe in the future, traveling for specific purposes. Okay? But for meeting, for conference, attending conferences, maybe the new normal is we meet through the web.
Okay? Right.
Now we have currently experienced that. Now we had no problem with getting together with an MIT scholar. Although we have 12-hour difference,
but
we'll be able to have conference together
and have intellectual
and instantly ask questions and instantly get an answer. So I think that's great.
Okay? Right.
So there are some changes we have to face, or we have to take advantage of, but there are other things that will not be changed, that then we have to take a positive attitude to face the changes.
That's really great. So as I understand, Paul is saying change is not necessarily a bad thing. We can learn, we can get used to, and start to find a new way to continue to move on. When talking about change, another important force of change is being brought by new technology, such as artificial intelligence, big data, or the we call it blockchain, right? For example, in this book, I mentioned an interesting example in intellectual property area. You know, we do a lot of IP valuation before, right? IP valuation is kind of task that need sophisticated analyze, need a lot of heavy work. In the past, it's only to be done by a large corporation who has a sizable team of professional. Like I worked for the TBK before, I got 100 professional to work on this kind of IP valuation. But with AI and big data, small and media enterprise now could also benefit from this approach. They could analyze the industry's IP. At the same time, they could also access the big data in other areas, such as consumer behavior, such as market trend, or some of them may want to get their status data in the supply chain, in the value chain, so they can combine those data to generate insight more easily. This is what I'm providing service by my startup called Spring IP to small and medium enterprise. So also in the book, I mentioned about blockchain.
which is also an important mean to reduce the risk of intellectual property ownership dispute. Because as professor knows, the blockchain has a unique nature. It could record information, and once recorded, it's difficult to remove it. So if we have many inventors or many enterprises working on the same direction, it will be easier to understand who has this, who has made this invention first, right? So those are the observation that I have. But my question to Paul is that in addition to those interesting application in the IP area, what do we see other like revolutionary application or potential and useful application of this emerging technology? What is your view?
I would encourage you to describe a little more
this one
to the to the audience about the new business model that you have created. I would share with you last couple of decades of my career. I'm also searching for a new business model which can create more value. So along that line, and I have successfully organized two teams. One team is draft a new set of legislation. We call it securitization of financial assets. And then that was successful. Then we have another project where we'll pull a team together, a team of experts together. We have helped to do the legislation in Taiwan, but copy from some of the ideas from MIT professors to do the legislation on securitization of real estate. And so this is called REITs.
REITs.
Which has become a very successful financial product for all the banks.
That's right.
But then the third effort, actually in my time, I failed. That was the securitization of intangible property.
Including intellectual property.
Such as a patent, copyright, and so forth. Now, we went as far as studying the model of the singer, David Bowie. David Bowie came up with a securitization plan. I think probably some brilliant banker helped him to come up with that. Idea, sell units of this fund, and the profit of the fund is coming from his income, from performing,
the singer, singing.
I don't know how successful it is, but temporarily have helped David Bowie to raise fund, to pay for a bill, and then earn profit for himself, and for whoever who bought the certificate. That model, David Bowie's model, helped a little bit, but didn't help much. They come up with a more concrete plan for securitization of intangible property. But the biggest problem we encounter is valuation. Yeah, we don't know how to do valuation.
Appraise the value of an IP.
Because later on, I'm pretty sure you know better than I, because you've been in this field for a long time, been focusing on this. For instance, patent, you can view a patent as a piece of paper, a piece of document. But if they cannot produce value.
Paper didn't produce value.
This patent is useless.
Right.
So I think your idea is great. Your idea, if I understand, is called monetize intellectual property, monetize IP. Maybe you can describe to the audience a little more. I'm fully encouraging, I'm also fully impressed by any kind of innovative idea, innovative business model can resolve the problem that in my time I failed to resolve.
That's interesting, and I will do so as Paul suggested. But before that, I'd like to have Paul shed some light on us. You mentioned about business model, right? As I remember your teaching, technology itself is just something on paper. If you couldn't put it into a profit model, a business model, then it is nothing.
Sure.
Could you tell us more about that?
Yes. Mm-hmm. A good student read mm-hmm. books. Okay.
Right.
A good researcher doing good research.
Right.
But we can, in the market, we have a lot of science book,
right.
technology book available. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then I look at the effort mm-hmm. Taiwan has been doing. Okay. Now the government finance a lot of research institute.
Okay. Okay.
The parents encourage their children to study science, technology.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But how come, in terms of commercialization mm. of certain technology, Taiwan is not ahead of anybody, right? I can use a couple of examples.
So we have good technology, but not successful business, what do you mean?
Not successful in terms of okay. commercialization. And become a new business model that is popular in the world market. So for the recent couple of years, I've been focusing on mm-hmm. research on the reason why.
Okay.
Okay. And then I come up with perhaps a simple rule mm-hmm. of thumb, actually for everybody to discuss, you know, including the audience, including yourself.
We'll do so.
Yeah. You know, I develop a rule called 20-80% rule.
20-80%?
Yeah. Okay. In other words, you move the world ahead, mm-hmm. forward, and you need to come up with all kind of new business deal. The notable example is Facebook, okay?
I see.
Uber okay. Mm-hmm. and Airbnb. Okay? Mm-hmm. These are successful examples.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Fortunately or unfortunately, all happened in the United States.
Oh, yeah.
Okay?
Right.
So let's look at Facebook first. Okay? Without internet mm-hmm. as a technology, you would never work.